Hi everyone, welcome back to Difference Frames the World, a channel that offers a unique perspective on global events and how they shape the balance of power. We analyze major international developments in straightforward terms and publish videos daily. Please subscribe to the channel so you will not miss our daily uploads. Today, Emily will discuss a major moment for the People's Liberation Army Navy of China, the commissioning of its third aircraft carrier, the Fujian. Earlier this week, on November 5th, 2025, China officially commissioned the Fujian aircraft carrier, the first one that the Chinese say is entirely domestically designed and built. The ceremony took place in Sanya, Hainan province, with President Xi Jinping in attendance. The carrier features a full flat flight deck and advanced electromagnetic catapult systems for launching aircraft, a significant leap compared to China's previous two carriers. It's designed to launch heavier armed jet fighters, such as the J-35 stealth fighter or the KJ-600 early warning aircraft from the deck. It utilizes electromagnetic catapults similar to those found on Ford-class carriers, rather than the older ski jump or steam systems. However, its system is more reliable than the Ford-class carriers. It signals China's ambition to move from a coastal defense navy to one capable of more blue water operations farther from its shores. There are several layers of significance here. It is a technological leap. The transition to electromagnetic launch systems is a significant advancement. It enables the launch of heavier aircraft with full fuel and payloads and increases sortie rates. China thus bypasses some of the limitations of its older carriers. It is a symbol of power projection. China is signaling it wants to operate farther out beyond its immediate shorelines. The Fujian is part of that message. We can deploy carrier groups, we can send aircraft from an ocean-going platform, we are serious. It also has regional strategic implications. For nearby states like Japan, Vietnam, the Philippines, and for the US, a carrier with these capabilities changes some of the assumptions about maritime balance in the so-called Indo-Pacific. At the same time, it conveys a clear domestic message. Beyond its purely military impact, this is a demonstration of national pride and technological progress that the Chinese leadership is likely to emphasize for internal legitimacy and to project an image of advancement to the outside world. Despite the significant milestone, there are several reasons to take a measured view on how quickly this carrier can become a fully combat-ready force. Operational integration takes time. Launching the ship is one thing. Having the full carrier strike group, including destroyers, supply vessels, submarines, and coordinating air wings, as well as practicing operations and logistics, all of that takes years. One analyst estimated that at least another year would be needed for full operational capability. The Fujian carrier has propulsion and endurance limitations. It is conventionally powered. That limits endurance compared to US nuclear carriers. In other words, even as great as it is, it won't yet match the endurance of, say, a US supercarrier that can stay on station longer without refueling. It still takes time for China to build the support infrastructure. A carrier is only as good as its supporting fleet, like escorts, supply ships, refueling, aerial surveillance, and submarine defense. China is building this, but it's a big system to assemble. The Chinese aircraft carriers, all three of them, lack combat-tested experience, deployments, real operations, the unexpected problems that come with that. China has a significantly shorter period of carrier fleet deployment compared to the US, resulting in a steeper learning curve. Of course, we cannot ignore Chinese carriers' strategic limitations. While China is clearly advancing, there are still gaps. Fewer overseas bases, fewer years of experience with multiple carrier battle groups, for example. Analysts note that China is catching up, but not quite at equal with the US in several dimensions. Let's pull this into the bigger picture of strategy, geopolitics, and what watchers should pay attention to. The carrier is named Fujian after the name of a province in China located on the mainland facing Taiwan, which may hold symbolic significance. In the Qing Dynasty, 8 years before it was ceded to the Japanese, Taiwan had been part of Fujian province for more than 200 years. Observers expect China may use this platform for more ambitious exercises around the Taiwan Strait, the East China Sea, or even toward the so-called Second Island Chain. If China can reliably deploy carrier groups farther from its own shores, it changes how other navies must think about surveillance, deterrence, and possible responses. The carrier becomes a tool in a broader naval posture, not just defense near home. The US still has many more carriers and decades of operational experience, but China's advancement is erasing some of the distance between these two major navies. That has implications for alliances, arms races, and naval deployments globally. For China's leadership, this is a message. We are a major power with modern capability. That speaks to domestic audiences, to regional neighbors, and to global players. The Fujian is a leap forward, but there are still many miles to go before it becomes the fully mature tool of power that China ultimately intends it to be. It'll take time, operational experience, system integration, strategic deployment, and support infrastructure. And at every step of the way, others will be watching, responding, and adapting. The Fujian carrier is a milestone, but it is the end. Instead, it is a new start. Now people are looking forward to the country's fourth carrier, which China has officially confirmed it's under construction. According to a senior admiral from the People's Liberation Army Navy, there were no technical bottlenecks for the fourth carrier project. Satellite imagery shows hull sections for the ship at the Dalian Shipyard in Liaoning Province, first spotted in May 2024, and more clearly in September 2025. Multiple defense industry sources confirm that the fourth carrier, Type 004, will be nuclear-powered, equipped with electromagnetic aircraft launch systems, and have a significantly larger displacement than its predecessors, reaching 110 to 120,000 tons. The Chinese Defense Ministry, however, has not confirmed all details publicly, and a spokesperson stated only that carrier development is based on national security requirements and progress in equipment technology. The fourth carrier is under construction, and the design is ambitious. However, much remains uncertain about power, deployment, and capabilities. Still, compared to China's earlier carriers, the Type 004 is designed for a leap in capability, featuring nuclear propulsion for significantly longer endurance, less frequent refueling, and a more sustained presence at sea. The Type 004 carrier is developed and built based on the Fujian carrier, aiming for full catapult launch and arrested recovery, which enables heavier aircraft, a more diverse air wing, and faster sortie rates. Reports suggest its displacement is around 110,000 to 120,000 tons, and an air wing comprising perhaps 90 or more fixed-wing aircraft, as well as helicopters and drones. The fourth carrier is expected to shift China from a near-sea navy toward a more global sustained naval power, projecting further and staying longer. With a nuclear-powered carrier, China would have far greater flexibility to project naval power across open oceans, not just close to its shores. That alters regional calculations for countries such as Japan, Australia, India, and the US. The U.S. Navy currently dominates carrier capability globally. However, in 20 years, when the U.S. retires half of its Nimitz-class carriers and China puts three or more new carriers in service, the gap will be minimal. As China has a shipbuilding industry 200 times larger than the U.S., China may even surpass the United States, becoming the world's number one naval power. In a recent video, we discussed the world's first thorium molten salt reactor in China, and we believe it may be commercialized and even installed on China's new vessels in the near future, as it is not only the safest nuclear generator, but also the most cost-effective one. All U.S. aircraft carriers are nuclear-powered, but none of its other surface ships have nuclear generators on board because of cost concerns. China's thorium molten salt reactors may enable the country to power its future carriers and destroyers with nuclear power, thereby alleviating range anxieties in the future. China has just revealed plans for what could become the largest container ship ever built, and it is going nuclear, but not in the traditional way. The new vessel, called the KUN-24AP, will be powered by a thorium-based molten salt reactor. This Generation 4 design promises to be safer, cleaner, and more efficient than traditional uranium reactors. Built by Jiangnan Shipyard under the state-owned China State Shipbuilding Corporation, CSSC, the ship will carry up to 24,000 containers and aims for true zero emissions throughout its operating life. Thorium is abundant in China, making it an attractive, low-carbon energy source for future shipping. China already has a test thorium reactor running in the Gobi Desert, and it has proven successful, as we discussed in a previous video. Experts say this could be a game-changer for the global shipping industry. Nuclear-powered cargo ships would never need refueling during their 25-year lifespan and could dramatically cut carbon emissions. If China can power its container ships with thorium molten salt reactors, it is possible to install those reactors on its cruisers, destroyers, submarines, and logistics vessels. Technically, there are no barriers, because China does not place a high priority on costs when modernizing its troops and the country aims to achieve energy self-reliance. It is reasonable to conclude that China's carrier groups may adopt nuclear capabilities in the foreseeable future. It is worth mentioning that a U.S. strike group must refuel its surface ships every 4,000 to 6,000 nautical miles, as it is impossible for U.S. cruisers to reach east of Taiwan or the Philippines from the U.S. homeland without refueling. If China could power its major surface ships with thorium molten salt reactors, that would be the nightmare for the U.S. Navy. Two valleys deep and fields of gold, stories of courage.
shy, very tall, and every soul.